Inside this ordinary-looking mobile disk external data storage hard drive enclosure is something very special. A 750GB IDE hard drive, the largest size of IDE hard drive ever made. The IDE interface, also known as parallel ATA, which uses this wide ribbon cable, was rapidly being phased out and replaced by serial ATA, which we all know and love as SATA or SATA, by the time this Seagate Barracuda 7200.10 750GB drive was made in September 2007. Seagate was the only company to make IDE hard drives with this large of a capacity, and in fact these 750GB IDE drives were only sold for OEM use. They were not sold directly to consumers. I came across this drive in 2015 when I found it in a non-functional iOmega external hard drive enclosure, and I made a video about it at the time when I repackaged it into this cheap CompUSA external hard drive enclosure, which I am the original owner of. I was using it to store backups of my video conversion projects, and one thing I like about this enclosure is that it has FireWire as well as USB. And all was well with this hard drive until a couple of days ago when I was using it to transfer about 80GB of data. And since that's going to take quite a while over USB 2.0, I left it running while I went off and did other things. And when I came back to it about half an hour later, the transfer had failed. When I do video transfers for people, I tell them I keep a backup of it for at least 1 year. And not counting what I was copying when it bombed, the newest transfer project I had on the drive was from April 2024, just under 1 year ago. So even if the data on this drive is unrecoverable, I think I'll be okay. But before I assume that the 17.5-year-old hard drive in this enclosure has failed, of course there are other factors involved that could be the source of the problem, such as the power supply for the drive, the USB cable, of course the computer you're using, or the electronics built into the hard drive enclosure. Any of those could have been the source of the problem, not necessarily the drive itself. So to do some basic troubleshooting and eliminate those other factors, I switched to a different computer, and I'm going to use a different USB cable and a different power supply. I'll apply power. Sounds normal. I don't know if the camera's microphone picked it up, but I could hear it spin up and initialize. Now I'll plug it into the computer. That's a good noise. And there it is, appearing within seconds, the drive that I thought had died on me. Video archive, 750GB. To try to narrow down the source of the problem, I switched back to the original USB cable I was using and the original power supply. So let's see if this works. Sounds normal so far. There it goes. And within seconds, Windows 10 recognized it. But Windows did find errors on the drive, no doubt from when that large file transfer failed on me. So I'm going to do some diagnostics on the drive and see if it's still in good health or if I should retire it. Well, every time I try to use Windows 10 to repair the drive, it says there was a problem and it's unable to do so. But it never tells me what the problem was. So I'll need to do more tests on this drive. I tried good old check disk at the command prompt, and it says a disk read error occurred and an unspecified error occurred. Normally my go-to choice for testing drives is a program called Crystal Disk Info, but in this case it's not even detecting that hard drive. It's only showing the computer's own SSD, probably because that old USB hard drive interface is not passing through any of the smart diagnostics data that this program relies on. So the solution to that is to crack open this hard drive enclosure and take out that hard drive. It's just sitting in here. It's not even screwed in place. Disconnect the cables. And I'm going to put this into a desktop computer which has an IDE interface built into its motherboard. Unfortunately, there was a pretty narrow window in the mid-2000s between when computers gained 48-bit logical block addressing to support IDE hard drives larger than 128 gigabytes, and around 2007 when they started phasing out support for IDE as SATA drives were taking over. Luckily, rescued from the e-waste bin, I have this Dell Optiplex GX620 from 2006, which is new enough to support 48-bit LBA, but old enough to still have an IDE interface, as you can tell by this rather old DVD-ROM drive I have installed, so it will fully support this hard drive. And right there in the system setup on the parallel ATA interface, it detected the Seagate ST3750840A 750 gigabyte IDE hard drive. I'm going to use this option in Windows to scan for and attempt recovery of bad sectors, and I'll let you know how it turns out. It's going to take quite a while. After about 2 hours, it says the disk was successfully scanned and no problems were found. But that doesn't necessarily give us a clean bill of health, because the drive itself may have already detected some bad sectors and reallocated them. And sure enough, when I run Crystal Disk Info, it plays the warning chime and gives me a health status of caution for that hard drive. That's because the drive has 3 reallocated sectors, which is not necessarily a sign of imminent failure, but is definitely something to keep an eye on to see if it gets any worse, and also a reminder to back up the contents of the drive if you haven't already. For now, what I'm doing is taking that same 81 gigabytes of data that I was trying to copy to the drive when it crapped out on me when it was in that external USB enclosure, and copy it to the drive now that it is connected directly to the computer's motherboard. Because I noticed that even when I got the drive working again in this enclosure, every once in a while when it was just sitting there doing nothing, the USB would disconnect and then immediately reconnect. So there could be a problem with the electronics in this drive enclosure, and that could have actually been the source of the failure when it was copying all that data the first time, not the drive itself. That data copied without any errors, and the number of reallocated sectors has not increased, so I think the drive is okay for now. And it just so happens that today I found this SimpleTech external USB hard drive for $3.99 at Goodwill. And when I take it apart, it has a Samsung 400GB drive inside, but it's not SATA like you might expect, it's PATA. Sure enough, it's an IDE drive. And here is that Seagate 750GB IDE drive being repackaged into the new enclosure, which hopefully will be more reliable than that cheap CompUSA enclosure I was using. Because frankly, I think the drive itself was just a red herring. It's probably fine. I mean, yeah, it has 3 reallocated sectors. And no, I'm not going to pick up that phone right now. But I think the drive itself is still okay, and it was that enclosure that was the source of the problem. And hopefully putting it into this one will fix the problem. And the good thing about this new enclosure is that unlike the old cheap CompUSA one, it is passing through the smart data. So that way I can use Crystal Disk Info to keep an eye on it and make sure those reallocated sectors aren't getting any worse. And yes, this Samsung 400GB drive that came out of the SimpleTech enclosure is fine as well, and I'm just going to put it in this CompUSA enclosure for now, because otherwise I don't really have a use for it. Because all of my desktop PCs, which are old enough to only support IDE and not SATA, are also old enough to not support hard drives larger than 128 gigabytes, like this Compact Desk Pro EN. So that's why these larger capacity IDE hard drives lived on much longer in these external enclosures than they did in desktop PCs. So the world's largest capacity IDE hard drive lives on, and it's now actually in its third enclosure, because like I mentioned, it was originally in an iOmega enclosure, which totally died. It didn't even turn on. And then I transferred it into this CompUSA enclosure, which still works but has questionable reliability, especially during large file transfers. So that's no longer trustworthy. So I moved it into this SimpleTech enclosure I found at Goodwill, which hopefully will work well for quite a while to come.